rather a very good pre-evening to all my esteemed panelists, audiences. Welcome to MasterSoft Presents Higher Education Leadership Conclave. As a tradition at MasterSoft, before we begin anything, we always go with the Saraswati Vandana to seek the blessings of Goddess Saraswati. I would request host to please start the Saraswati Vandana. Before we begin, I would like to welcome my esteemed panelists. We have with us Dr. S.S. Gokhale, former Dean IIT Madras, Director of NIT Calicut, NIT Nagpur, NIT Raipur, NIT Mizoram, Director of LNM IIT Jaipur. Sir has worked in the field of education throughout the length and breadth of the country. We welcome you, sir. We have with us Professor Dr. Lalit Kumar Awasthi, Director of NIT Jalandhar. We welcome you, sir. We have with us Dr. S. Shanta Kumar, Director of Gujarat National Law University. We welcome you, sir. We have with us Professor Dr. Mahendra Sharma, Pro Chancellor and Director General of Ganpat University, Ahmedabad. We welcome you, sir.
Namaskar.
Good afternoon, all of you. It's so nice to have you. First of all, thank you so much for accepting my invite and being on MasterSoft Presents Higher Education Leadership Conclave. These are indeed very strange times. I have my panelists joining across the length and breadth of the country, and it's so great to have all of you. My first question is, all of you have been associated with education for a very long period. And I'm sure nobody has seen these kind of circumstances before on, you know, what is happening now. As decision makers, as academicians who have been watching the education fraternity, what were your initial responses when you heard about the lockdown, when you heard that institutions are going to be shut down physically, and you know, there was little clarity on what COVID is and what is going to happen? What were your initial thoughts and what were the first decisions that you took as a policymaker, as a decision maker? I would request Director of NIT Jalandhar, Professor Dr. Lalit Kumar Awasthi, to please throw some light on this, and we'll be having the same question to all the other panelists.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Greetings from NIT Jalandhar. I congratulate MasterSoft for this very good initiative of bringing different leaders from education to talk on this pandemic situation. When I first got this news, there were two aspects. The immediate aspect was how the students of our institute can reach their home places safely. So this was one thing on my mind, that whether some of the students were there, that the research student asked that they can be in the hostels, but we thought it will be worth sending them and asking them to come later on if the situation improves. So that proved to be a good decision. The second was how the teaching, learning and research should continue. So once the students were off and the teachers faculty were not able to come to the institution due to lockdown, then there was immediate, roughly we were left with 35% of the contents, roughly 12 lectures each course. So we started online classes and we used Google Zoom, Google Classroom for teaching the students. So that was the initial step, but it was a little bit difficult for some students because they were not connected and they were having some connection problem. Then we thought of that we can try to disseminate the recorded lectures of the faculty. So that was the second step which we took. The third step was that we even went for audio recording of lectures, if not possible, that video recording is not downloadable and things like that. So there were some initial responses from the student and from the faculty. But because the faculty were also in, some of the faculty members were in some locations where there was internet connectivity problems. So once the situation improved and faculty came back to the campus, then we went for the second round of classes. And these classes were held by having faculty on campus and then disseminating the lectures to the student online. And it is roughly 80 to 90% of the faculty members have now recorded lectures available. And these lectures have been shared with the student. Also, they have used Google Classroom for disseminating these lectures.
Okay.
This was the complete response. And then we had a second phase also, which we can come in later on. I discussed the problem with the student, and then they thought that more lectures for problem solving should be disseminated.
Okay. My same question to Dr. Shanta Kumar, sir. Sir, what happened at JNLU?
Yeah. So in fact, this is, as you rightly said, this was a totally a new experience. We were not prepared completely to handle this. So the, as rightly pointed out by Director NIT Jalandhar, our immediate concern was to send the students safe because ours is a residential university. And being a national university, we have students from every corner of the country. So immediate concerns was to see that all of them reach their homes safely. And we allowed a week for them to travel and another week for them to settle down because of the hype and all the crisis that was created by this pandemic. Then we used this 2 weeks time as an institution to gear up, to see how best we can manage to handle this situation, especially to reduce mitigate the loss of learning. So our concern was that this should not affect their teaching learning in any way. Therefore, we immediately arranged for procuring the licenses for Cisco WebEx. So we went for WebEx because at that particular point of time, there were certain controversies going around Zoom, and therefore we thought of going for WebEx. So we got every teacher a separate user license so that they can have their lectures recorded, and then it comes with a lot of facilities where you can store these lectures for a year in the cloud and all those advantages. So we went for Cisco WebEx, and then third week we started classes because teaching through laptop or through this camera is something new for our teachers. We never did it except for certain Skype meetings. We were not very familiar with this model of teaching. So therefore, this was a new experience, irrespective of your age and experience in the teaching profession. For everybody, it was new. That how do we handle classes, speaking before the camera, especially when students are not there. And in fact, law is not as that kind of a subject, you know, where you can keep on talking about it. It requires a lot of interaction. It requires a lot of discussion and interpretation of each and every word, applying a given section of a law to a particular situation and then explaining it. So all these things were the real challenge. So initially what we did was we had to encourage teachers to go for online method. We said that, okay, you decide your class timing, you talk to the students, find out their convenience. And so some teachers had their classes late in the night, even at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, because the students wanted, they felt that the bandwidth will be available at 10 o'clock in the night. Some had it early morning, some had it in the afternoon. So for 2 weeks, it was going on, subject to the convenience of the teachers as well as to the students. Then we got control of the situation. By now, teachers got very experienced. They have now used to delivering lectures online, and they have learned all the tips of using technology for teaching. And then after 2 weeks, then we started a regular timetable based classes. So it went on very well. So we extended the semester by a month to make good the loss that we had to lose the number of teaching days. So we extended the semester by a month and we completed the semester. So we had a target of 45 lectures per subject. So we could complete, and in certain cases, we even, a few teachers have crossed even 50 lectures in those subjects. So that whatever, because some certain students in certain localities, they were not able to have access to these facilities. Therefore, keeping that in mind, we did it. And in fact, there were requests that video streaming becomes difficult because of low, especially areas where they do not have a 4G connection. Then, you know, it was all buffering. So then we had to go for podcasting. So we recorded audio lectures, and then many of our teachers recorded audio lectures, and then they sent this podcast to the students, which was easy for students to listen at their own convenient time. So we tried and experimented. I will not say that what we did was the perfect thing expected out of an institution, but we managed the situation. I think we did our level best to ensure that no student had lost anything in terms of teaching environment. So this is all what we did.
Okay, congratulations, sir, for this.
Thank you.
And before I come to Dr. Gokhale, I would like to move to Sharma, sir, for, you know, Ganpat University is one of the largest universities in Gujarat with thousands of students and teachers. And they have played a very important role in the education of Gujarat. So, sir, again, coming to you, thousands of students in your campus, a large campus, a very large campus, students from across the world, I believe. How was it, sir? And tell us something more about what were you feeling? Was there a lot of pressure? And I'm sure there would have been a lot of pressure. And what were the immediate decisions you made?
Yeah. Thank you, Gurudev. In fact, when the first case landed in Delhi, we had a marathon meeting in first week of March. And we took a lot of inputs from government directly of what's coming and what's happening. And we took certain proactive measures. Our proactive measures were fourfold. First was, we had around 6,000 students in our hostels. So before 15th of March, we moved our students to their home. We did not wait for the lockdown. And 16th of March, we went online with the education. So from the first week and the second week, we went into full preparation mode of going online. Government of Gujarat had a scheme of giving tablets since last 3 years to all the students who were 10th pass and 12th pass. So students were having the gadgets. Government had already given, and then there were schemes supporting with the Wi-Fi also. So it was well connected. We became proactive in that measure. We went online by 16th of March. We conducted almost more than 15,000 sessions. By end of April, almost 550 faculties conducted online sessions. we were the first one in Gujarat to complete our mock online examination as well as full examinations without any hitch. We have declared the results also. You will be surprised to know that 116 companies during lockdown conducted online placement, and we did not stop the effort there. So it was not about only the teaching examination and ensuring that they remain on their path. The placement activity went ahead, and when it was covered in media that 116 companies were conducting online, it was a surprise, and I received a call from the government complimenting, saying the efforts are really in shape with what we are planning to do. So we never thought of putting a break anywhere, but Ganpat University, our motto is we are a socially responsible university. Our second response was we needed our 5 kilometer radius area to be corona free. So we resolved that we will take all the steps as part of our social responsibility. So we adopted 25,000 families around the campus. We started distributing Ayush Mantralaya ministry prescribed homeopathic and Ayurvedic drugs. This happened in second week of March. We did not wait for the lockdown. We had distributed the medicine by then. And by third week, we got our employees, they came forward, donated their 1 day salary, and we went for having 1 lakh masks, which we got manufactured and we distributed. And we did not stop there. Our pharmacy college started working on a gel which would survive on your hands for 4 to 5 hours, protecting it. So if you don't wash it, it would help you. So we developed that formula and we gave it to the government because we never wanted to manufacture it. So we developed that and we gave. For immunity boosting, we came out because health workers were working. So our food technology department, they developed a high immunity boosting khakra. Gujarat, it is it's a staple food. So we developed that khakra and we supplied 5,000 kgs of those khakras to civil hospitals and police administration, both in Mehsana and Ahmedabad. So we ensured that we did that. And our mechatronics students by April end developed a nursing robot so that the doctors and nurses, they don't need to go near the patient to administer and to check their temperature. So that robot was in place and we gave it to the Mehsana Civil Hospital Administration. And then our robotics club and the drone club, they started modifying existing drones so that could be used to spray sanitizers in areas where it was difficult for health workers to go. And till date also, the 5 kilometer radius of the campus is still corona free. And we are continuously monitoring. We have ensured that everybody has downloaded the Arogya Setu app. We go there every 3 days to take their temperature. We keep the calendar to ensure that the homeopathic drug, which is a monthly cycle, that cycle they follow, and we ensure that they are taking the drugs properly. So it's like we went ahead and fulfilled our social responsibility. We ensured that the campus remained corona-free. We ensured our students remained free. And right now also, our network has been established. So that while they were at home, you will not believe, we conducted yoga classes for almost 1.5 months, 6 to 7 a.m. in the morning, broadcasted to the community. And we said, you at home, you have to be healthy. And parallel counseling sessions went. And this was our response. And we did not wait for the lockdown. We are the only university in the home district of our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Bhai. So it became more responsible because we had to act fast. So we moved fast and we relied on a lot of inputs coming from the government. And we worked very closely with the district administration. And I can tell you, even when we conducted online examinations and when almost 12,000 students took the exam online, it was in the remotest corner. It was Gram Panchayat, or it was police administration, they helped us like anything. and they came and they ensured. There were certain cases where connectivity was not working. We requested, we reached out to the government agencies, and I must compliment that in spite of the troubles they might be facing, they ensured that they made those facilities available to the kids so that they could complete their examination. So ours was a fourfold response, and we are still learning and we want to improve it further. So this is how we reacted and acted.
I think, sir, I will be coming back to you to ask you more questions on that in the next round, because I would like to ask Dr. Gokhale now. Sir, you are one of the most experienced panelists that I have today. You have worked in Madras, you have worked in Calicut, you have worked in Nagpur, you have worked in Jaipur. I don't think there is any part of the country that remains where you have not worked. And I have been looking and you know, we have been interacting. You have managed large campuses, like campuses as high as 100 acres and 150 acres. You have been the directors in these campuses. What are the key top three things that in such a pandemic that a decision maker should do when such kind of issues come up? And I would just like you to share your experiences, and since you have also been associated with AICTE and NPA, what is the role that government bodies play during such circumstances?
Good afternoon to you all. Right now, I am not in any executive position. So whatever I am mentioning it to you is what I was able to do it independent of it. To start with, Corona was virtually chasing us in Kerala. It was the first state, you know, which identified, you know, that this particular pandemic is going to be taking a big toll. So we were at that time in IIIT Kottayam. You know, both myself and my wife, we were teaching one credit course. There for about 10 days, then from there we went to Kozhikode, and from there we flew out. So Corona was chasing us, and we survived that particular part, and then we came back to Pune, which is my hometown. My brother is a medical doctor, and we have a hospital in Pune. And since I am a super senior citizen, he declared a lockdown on me, saying, you know, you shall not get out anywhere for next 15 days. It suited me fine, you know. In between, you know, I am also associated with MIT ADT in Rajbagh, Pune. And we had a series of meetings over there, you know, starting with a webinar, which I piloted. You know, this was on aerospace. I started that particular seminar series. And then a lot more people, they came in and joined, K. Kiran Kumar, you know, Kasturi Rangan, Vasagam, and so on and so forth. Since I'm basically aerospace engineer, you know, most of these people I knew. So I was partly involved with these types of webinar type of activity. In between, you know, academic senate meeting, board of studies meeting, etc. for this ADT took place. And we were conducting it in a remote, this particular way, you know, in which, you know, we are right now interacting. So this is the first part of it. Second part of it is that I started collecting a variety of information from various sources, you know, saying, you know, what is this pandemic all about? A highly unpredictable creature. And those of you who follow things, you know, you would know that these types of disruption can cause major upheaval into the society. So this pandemic caused upheaval, you know, in the education, in the healthcare, in the economy, in the jobs, in the migrant workers, and everything else with which you guys are familiar. I tried to concentrate a little bit on the education part of it, you know, because that being the closest that I could come. So my first gut feeling about it is that the student anxiety, not necessarily the ones who are on campus. On campus, students also had a difficulty, because when the lockdown was announced in Kerala, I was there very much amongst them. And again, as everybody is mentioning, NIT Jalandhar also had the same problem, that you had to safely send these students back home in the custody of their parents, and care would be provided to them. So I was discussing these issues with the IIIT Kottayam director as well as the NIT Gurukul director. And we were trying to find out, what are the do's and don'ts. This type of a lockdown was unprecedented. Previously, when there are some disruptions, on account of student unrest and so on and so forth, we used to send the students away for a short period, away from the hostels, so that the trouble doesn't brew and so on and so forth. But sending the whole campus out was indeed something which was unprecedented. As I started mentioning, I started looking at the students who want to enter into the professional education. And they have got the various variety type of examinations, right? The common entrance tests are there. Nobody knows when they will be completed. Nobody knows when the JEE main will be completed. If the JEE main doesn't come through, then JEE advance will not be. If JEE advance doesn't take place, then the NITs will not have their fill. IITs will not have their fill. And then the rest of the, private institutions, which are at the bottom of the stack, So this would have a little bit of a cascading effect. And that anxiety and uncertainty is something which is weighing on the minds of all the students. And quite honestly, I do not know how to circumvent it. Various ministries, they are putting out various types of notifications from time to time about the examinations, to have it, not to have it, all over the country or only particular state and so on and so forth. There are containment zones, movement is badly affected. And I am in a state where this pandemic is probably at the peak. It has not achieved that particular, I'm not talking peak in terms of the medical type of thing, but the number of persons who are affected, number of deaths, and so on and so forth. Mumbai, Pune being close to each other, this has really shaken up everybody. This has really shaken up everybody. Coming to the online courses that have been taken up, I just wanted to bring out one point and then I will return back to it as and when your next particular thing comes through. What should be the orientation of the academic administrator? Should the orientation be on the compliances? That means 90% or 95% of my lectures are delivered or so and so forth. Or my orientation should be on the quality. And this quality aspect of it, as of now, it yet remains to be tested. My personal feeling is that we have entered into the era where the hybrid learning, bringing in a little bit more of a computer compared to the brick mortar type of a thing, that thing is going to be indeed the order of the day. However, in this particular blended education platform, we are not quite sure how to work with it. Previously, there were open source softwares, there were open source softwares were available, OCWs were there, NPTEL was there, Swayam is there, and so on and so forth. But they were in a collaborative type of a mode and not necessarily in this type of a replacement mode. So this is something which is slightly bothering me. What should be our orientation? Our orientation should be on the compliances or on the quality of the teaching learning processes, taking it to the level that you would be able to justify that academic rigor is maintained. I compliment all the previous speakers, you know, they have done a wonderful job, you know, especially in Gujarat, you know, if you have been able to do such a remarkable thing by adopting villages and so on and so forth. And Gujarat is not too far behind Maharashtra as far as the pandemic is concerned, you know. So, you know, in light of that, you know, I think you have done wonderfully well, and I compliment you. There's a lot to learn from you and a lot to emulate you. And if we are able to go through this particular process, you know, and Gurudev Somwani's attempt at putting the people from different walks of life connected with the education and from different parts of the country is commendable, because all of us have something to learn from each other. So the best practices, if we are able to adopt it and if we are able to map it into our own situation, I think there is nothing like it. This is what I wanted to say in the opening remarks, you know, that were expected from me. Thank you.
Sir, before I move forward, I would like to ask you, quality or compliance, what will you prefer?
Personally, quality. Because how do you ensure the self-esteem of the student is maintained? Now, what are we doing in Maharashtra? You know, we said, you know, that there will be no examinations. You know, we will either interpolate or extrapolate the marks, you know, and then award them degrees and so on and so forth. I feel, you know, that is sort of a self-defeating, you know, because the students don't feel good about it. They wanted examination. They want to earn their degree. And that particular self-esteem is something, you know, which I believe is much more important than merely, you know, filling the bucket. Compliance is basically filling the bucket, you know. So I would prefer, you know, maybe we would, as somebody was mentioning, you know, you took one more extra month, you know, to complete. Fine, fair enough, you know. But we are not going to cut corners. We are not going to cut corners. And how we are going to make this particular thing work is a challenge. It indeed is a challenge. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. That was very, very enlightening. I would like to come to Awasthi, sir. And, you know, we will pick up from where Dr. Gokhale left. I will ask you the same question, sir. Quality or compliance? And how do we ensure quality? You know, we have been hearing a lot about, you know, to conduct examination. We have been hearing about LMS. We have been hearing about proctoring-based examinations. We have heard a lot about online teaching and classroom teaching. But since Dr. Gokhale left it on examinations, I would like to ask you, what would you prefer? Classroom examinations or online examination through proctoring or any other means?
Dear Gurudev Somwani, Professor Gokhale had put it at the right place. It is quality and quality and quality. For an institution of national importance like NIT Jalandhar, who is leading in one of the north side of the country, it is definitely quality. I would like to share some of the initiatives which faculty and staff has taken at the institute before I come to your question for examination. At NIT Jalandhar, the faculty members, they came as a group to have around 200 cooked food to the needy. So it was difficult to have cooked food and then distribute, but we could distribute it during the pandemic time. The second initiative was similar to, as has been said by Professor Sharma, all faculty staff, they came close and they donated one day salary. And then being institution of technical institution, we need to come up with some good technical solutions to this pandemic. So we made innovation at pandemic, and In that case, I told that we will be able to sponsor some project by using the TQ fund, especially for COVID-19. So a lot many developments have come. The faculty have developed herbal hand sanitizer, Sue Soul sanitizer facility, PPE kits facility, easy breathe mask because we are having a textile engineering department, then a robot for isolation wards, then UV-based floor cleaner. This technology has been patented and has been marked to a Vadodara-based company. They are manufacturing this now. And then UV-based item sanitizer, a face shield, and a body sanitizing capsule. These are the developments that have taken place, and five things have been patented. And we have also come with some social responsibility by distributing the sanitizer to the police, local police, to CRPF, to BSF. So that was the gesture from the institute side. Coming back to your question on examination quality, and there have been a lot of challenge as a director, because we need to look for the first challenge was the challenge of placement, as has been told by Dr. Sharma, that they arranged so many online placement for the students. We had roughly 80% students placed by the time we were into the pandemic. So later on, we have to go for online placements. Plus, we need to look for how these already placed students can join in time. So this was a great challenge. The second challenge was the third year student in an engineering institution, they need to go through industrial training. Yeah. Industrial training. So this is another challenge which we faced. And the third most important challenge, which I put number one, is the challenge of mental and physical health of my students, because they are not in the institute. They are in their houses. They may be having some burden due to maybe limited internet or any other thing. So I started in the same way. We had interaction with the students for their mental and physical health. And then we had webinars on yoga and meditation, art of living. These were open to students and they attended them nicely. The second thing was related to the placement. So at NIT Jalandhar, we took a decision that for final year student, because they're already into their job offers were ranging between 15 June to 16 June, 17 after that. So we thought that we'll not be able to take their examination immediately. So what we did is that we took the average of 7 semester and then added that into their tally, whatever exam we had already taken, plus the assignments, and that the result has been declared and the students have joined. Some of the students have joined their designated positions in the industry. The second part was because as a leader for this institute, I know that if we take a student in first year, second year, third year, and don't ask him to appear for the examination, then probably he may not be good in its successive years. And it will be just having a hollow foundation and then having a tall building on that. So we have taken a decision that we'll be having a open book test for first year, second year, third year students. And weightage has been arranged that the first test weightage has been there around 30%, then assignments and around 20%, the previous semester's CGPA 20%, and the open book test will be 30%. So a new weightage scheme has been in. And when we talked to the student, they thought because we have to go for examination, give us some more time. So we have given them 10 extra days based on their input. And now the examination will start from 16th of this month. There is a little bit problem with some of the very few students, maybe 8-9 students, which are from J&K. they are not having connectivity. So that remains in my mind that we need to look for how they can be alternatively compensated, what can be done best for them. As far as the industrial training was concerned, the institute came with the packed with the Coursera online, and they had provided all their courses free of cost for my student and faculty till July 31st. So we came up with an alternative that the students who can join online training, that is good. If they are not able to join online training, they go through a series of courses on Coursera. If they pass that, give that certificate, we presume that they have done their industrial training. So that kind of arrangement has been made by the Senate of the Institute. So these are some of the challenges and how we address to them at NIT Jalandhar.
I think Professor, flexibility, trust are perhaps perhaps have played a very important role. Your unique approach of open book test would not have been possible without, you know, without getting off tradition, especially for an old institution that is of national importance to go for such kind of unique approach. I won't call it unique because it has happening all across, but for a institution of national importance, this is indeed a very unique approach. So congratulations to you for that. And I also read somewhere about air purifier that NIT Jalandhar made.
Yes, definitely we have dealt that air purifier, and the technology has been transferred for air purifier as well. And this is also being manufactured and will be available in the market very soon.
So I think one pandemic, and I say this with full responsibility, that I'm sure you would have been doing this prior to the pandemic also, but one pandemic, we have known the importance of national institutions or even large private universities, the impact that they have on that area. And I believe there has to be a very healthy competition among all institutions, so that, you know, for the positive impact that they have on the society.
So, yes, I second the thought of our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji, that we need to make this, convert this challenge into opportunity. So NIT Jalandhar, by all means, my faculty members have seconded it with me, and I have provided them all financial assistance through TQ3, and we have come up with a solution for every small problem which has been created by pandemic COVID-19.
Congratulations to you. And I would now like to come to Dr. I would now like to come to Dr. Shanta Kumar. Sir, I'll be taking the same question that Dr. Gokhale started. Quality or compliance, and your thoughts on managing examinations and learning in these times.
I would
request, since you are from a legal background, I'm sure your answer is going to be compliance.
But at the same time, you know, no, there can't be any second opinion on compromising quality. Quality is must, you know, especially for a university of our repute. I don't think we can even think of compromising on quality.
But sir, I believe, sir, as Avasthi sir said, that you have to declare the results for the betterment of the students. So I think compliance is also equally important.
That's right. Yes.
I would request to throw some more light on that.
Correct. See, in fact, we had two sets of guidelines. One coming from the University Grants Commission. So the UGC came out with a big document, which was prepared by an expert team, wherein they gave each university the autonomy to choose out of or within the limits prescribed in the guidelines. There were various models that we had the option to select from. How do we complete the assessment and how do we declare the results. That is one thing. Second is, as a law university, we are governed by our regulator, the Bar Council. So the Bar Council of India came out with a set of norms, and they said that you can go ahead and declare your results based on certain things. So we picked up, you know, in fact, the option was the option was given by the Bar Council for the final year students. They said that you can, if you have conducted the continuous evaluation and if you have done your midterm evaluations and the internal evaluation marks are done, then you can double it up and then you can declare the results of the final year examination, because in our case, the results were supposed to be published in June, so that by July 1st, people were supposed to join. Though, because when it comes to placement in our case also, like even before the pandemic, 86 of our students got placed. So we'll have to see that they don't, they're joining the new office should not be affected and all these reasons. So we went by the Bar Council guidelines and then we strictly followed and complied with the norms, and then we declared the results of the final year examination, final year students, the graduating batch. So that now we declared it last week, and then now the graduating batch is preparing themselves to go ahead, and because we are now in the process of issuing the provisional degree, their transcript, complete all the 10 semesters transcript and other things. It's all getting ready. So within a week, it will be dispatched to them, and then students can take these certificates and go on. If they want to practice before courts, they will go to the respective state bar councils and enroll there and start practicing. And I could see that, you know, today, in fact, I got a call from the Bar Council of Gujarat. They were very proactive in helping students by telling us that, you know, if it will take time for you to print mark sheets and give provisional degrees and other thing, you can give us the list of students who have graduated this year, so that based on your list, we will allow them to enroll as a lawyer. That is the level of support the government is providing, the Bar Council is providing, and the universities are providing. So I think we have all responded very well to this situation, keeping in mind all the difficulties what every one of us is undergoing, primarily the students, because they, for them, the future was in a big question. They were all not sure whether they will be able to complete this semester, whether the results will come, whether they will be able to take up the jobs, whatever was assured to them. So we had to work, you know, keeping in both these two things, compliance and quality. Of course, compliance is, as you said, when we have a regulator, it's always good to be on the right side of the law. So we had to comply with the regulator, especially in our case, the Bar Council of India. So we strictly went by their model, whatever they've suggested. And as far as the intermediate semesters, the other batches who are not graduating, Bar Council said that you will have to conduct their examination when they come back to the campus, whenever they will be back in campus. So we are now waiting for the students to visit our campus in the next semester. Whenever, we do not know whenever it will happen. But without waiting for the physical coming, we are commencing our classes in July. So through online mode, this semester we are planning to commence as per our academic calendar. The classes will be commenced for the rest of the batches through online. And the online classes will keep on going until things becomes normal, when we can call them to our campus. Then we will conduct this. So this is the arrangement that we have made as of now. Thank you so much.
Perfect, sir. That is so great. And I'm sure as a national law university, you would be also be able to help a lot of law colleges or you know, normal colleges that run the law courses, maybe arts, commerce, science colleges, which also have a part-time law courses. You would be also able to support a lot of those with, because especially now that you know, learning is happening online, everybody should have access to the best teachers. So I'm sure you will be also working in that direction, where yes, at least in Gujarat, you will be able to support the other law institutions.
Yes, So these two ways we are doing it. One is to provide quality legal education, access to quality legal education. Fortunately for us, a law professor, he during this pandemic, who was a very senior experienced professor, he quit his job and then he started a virtual law school only to provide access to all these students. So which was a pro bono class, like, you know, and he got the support from even former judges of the Supreme Court, some very eminent senior advocates in the Supreme Court, and then a team of law professors. In fact, we also associated with the virtual law school. And this is now available to any student from anywhere in the country for any subject. They will be able to join this particular program and doing it. So we are doing this way. We are supporting that virtual law school initiative taken by our colleague, law professor called Professor Nachiketa Mittal. He is doing a wonderful job, and we are providing all possible support, including, you know, providing all the technical support to ensure that the virtual law school continues pro bono without charging any fees. That was one thing that we did.
Something amazing.
Second thing what we did was, you know, because last 2-3 months we had a lot of problems associated with migrant laborers moving from one place to another place. So our the Center for Law and Society, almost around 200 students, they set up a committee, and then they went for crowdfunding to mobilize money to help all these migrants, mostly from our alumni. So they did not go to the public. Our alumni supported our present students, and then we had mobilized a good amount of money, which the students used to call the migrant laborers from multiple places and make them assemble at one particular point. They engaged buses, you know, they hired buses, paid the buses for their completing. Then they got all clearances from the collector, from the police department, of the sending state and the receiving state at all these places. I think we have helped around 8,000 migrant laborers reach their homes safely. So this is one social work.
I think, sir, this initiative of yours deserves a big round of applause, because, you know, if we would have been able to replicate and spread this across the country, the scenes that we would have seen on the television would have been completely different.
Yes.
But kudos to you and your university that at least 8,000 of them have been able to reach home and safely and smoothly.
Before sending them, we were, you know, temporarily hosting them by providing all meals. And then there were people who were not willing to go home also, who were willing to stay back and look for their jobs whenever it will resume. So they wanted some amount of ration, food and other things. So in that cases, we engaged, we used only, we asked them to go to the nearby shop wherever they would, they have access to grocery store. They went to the grocery store and we spoke to the vendors over phone, and our students immediately asked for their Paytm numbers, and then our Google Pay or Beam UPI. And then from here, we transferred the money, you know, while depending on the bill of that migrant laborer. So by this way, we had provided almost for 5,000 migrant laborers, migrant workers, food, the ration for at least a month. So we...
Congratulations. I think this is simply amazing. Coming to Dr. Mahendra Sharma, sir. Sir, from drones to masks to immunity boosting khakras, and, you know, taking care of a 5-kilometer radius. I don't think, and, you know, again, going back to the academics, conducting examinations, conducting classes, conducting campus placements, I think you have got it all right. Do you feel that, you know, what, I mean, do you still, I mean, after achieving so much during these tough circumstances, do you feel that you could have done something more? And this is my first question. And my second question, sir, I really like the idea of yours, which says that 5 kilometers is the radius where I will take care that there is no COVID. we have got many principals who are here today in this call, and from across the country. I won't say 5 kilometers. I'll say even 500 meter radius. If all colleges take care that there is no COVID in that radius, I think again we would have a very different scenario. How will you guide them, sir? So these are my two questions to you.
Gurudev, responding to the first part of your question, it's not the first time when the human spirit has taken over a situation. It has been a phenomena that whenever world has been thrown through these scenarios, it has happened after Spanish flu, it happened after World War II. Human beings have experimented with new ideas, and human life has gone to next level. And this opens up the opportunity of the next level of evolution. So when we look back, probably you were right that we did a lot of things, but we could do it because we read the lines getting written on the wall by remaining very much proactive with the government, with the information. And we kept track of what's happening in other countries. So it was so that because we have a lot of our founder lives in US, he is on the board of California Polytechnic University, and there are a lot of people in US. So we were learning very fast. We said, if this is how this virus is going to behave, and this would leave everybody into a state of staticness, we have to respond very fast. So that was something which came to us early, and we reacted, and we could have, we organized us ourselves properly. But having said so, it's always a feeling of preparedness. The time.
Sir, you are inaudible. Hello, Dr. Sharma, you are inaudible.
You get.
Yeah, I think there is some problem with your internet.
Yeah. Voice is breaking.
Okay, yeah. Am I audible now? Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible now. Can we just go back 10 seconds and we can start from there, please?
In fact, what I was telling was there is always a preparedness gap, which comes as a pinch. Because the time which we got to react was too less. And had we Government of Gujarat has a disaster management cell, and universities don't have a disaster management response teams. We teach disaster management, but we don't have emergency response teams. And we have committees and all such kinds of stuffs, which meets, deliberates, and our bureaucratic style of dealing with the situation. In fact, that was the thing that is still gives us a pinch that we could have done what we were doing better had we been given in, had we got some time to react to it faster. But yes, we learned a lot, and we still are looking, because everything happened so sudden. We migrated to online mode, but now we are more stable. We have stable platforms of delivery. We have more refined approaches of interacting with the students, with the parents, and to conduct classes. In fact, now we have gone into a mode where now we are preparing MOOCs. So content development has become very much organized. Each of my college now has 2 studios, which we developed by May. And now we have started going in a big way. So my entire preparation, July, December bracket, whatever may happen, government may open it or may not open it, all the subjects would have MOOCs supported by Coursera, edX, and all other platforms. My faculties are now collaborating with foreign professors who are readily available as of now. So it's like we have created an knowledge expressway. So it's like we don't want to miss this opportunity where we can give our students the best which can come to them. So we have even advised our professors that if there is a professor from Harvard who is ready to deliver, you will take a back foot and you will also assist him, and you will only do the counseling part of it. So it's where now we have renewed our approach and our thought processes. And we are going very much with the understanding that when we are looking at the critical competence of knowledge acquisition process, where the application of knowledge in problem solving is the criteria to judge the success of the acquisition of knowledge. We don't want to do any secondary stuff. Probably I may answer the first part in the first point is the satisfaction related to the delivery of the content. So now we would ensure that there is no gap in our satisfaction and that is properly audited. You will be surprised that when online education is done, in spite of guidelines, there is no methodology of quality audit into it. So we are working very hard along with a lot of professors abroad to ensure that we are bringing a quality audit process for online learning. And in the teaching learning process, teaching would have happened that we delivered, but learning which happens along with the enabling environment of sports, cultural activities, hostel life, enabling environment, that gap, how do we bring and fulfill that gap is the second thing we are working very hard on to. And probably the teaching learning methodologies that we are bringing now would help us complete a certain part of it. At Ganpat University, we had been very much conscious from day one. So we defined how our graduate should be. So we said every graduate, every student of the university must have five characteristics. So the first and the foremost was that the student must be critically competent in the domain of knowledge he or she has opted. The second one was that the student must be employable under all circumstances, must be employable. The third thing was must be innovative and enterprising. So we want to inbuild those characteristics. The fourth thing we said must be socially engaged. So he must have social composure, socially engaged, and must see society as an important ingredient of his life cycle. And the last thing was must be culturally competent. So when we go into an online education mode, we have done the first part. We did was we gave knowledge and we then thought about what would happen to second, third, fourth, fifth, where the student has to have hands-on interaction with the community, with the industry, with the experts. So our new methodologies, which we are evolving and which we are coming, we are trying to answer second, third, fourth, and fifth point, which I talked about. So when you say, are you satisfied? I am not satisfied because I could do the first part of it. And there also, there were gaps and we are trying to fill in those gaps. And the remaining part, we are evolving and now brought in technologies and tools where now what we can foresee is we will be doing justice to both the parents as well as society and the country by contributing holistically with each student in focus, all the five components. So this is how Gurudev, we are working very hard onto it. And I can tell you, it is very exciting journey because this is a particular situation which has put Indian higher education in the same situation in which everybody in the world is currently in. So there is no the best solution. So if Indian IT industry could create a space and a mark for India globally, probably the response to this pandemic by Indian higher education would give us a permanent space into the world higher education space. So it is our zeal with which we would respond and how we can take the best ability of our IT prowessness, of our IT industry, blend it and make the best of it. Indian higher education is set to evolve for the next level. And we as academicians have to play our role. Because if you look at the Western world also, there you will find it is Indian brains, which are actually, it is all Satyam Shivams and Nadellas who are playing their role. So it's Indian brain which will take our education's acceptability across border in this new evolved virtual world. So it's an opportunate time. And I foresee a lot of possibilities.
Perhaps, sir, I should have an offline conversation with you to understand the Ganpat education model. You know, from Gujarat model of governance, I believe Ganpat education has created a separate Ganpat education model that can be seen and that can be, you know, used by the rest of the country. Sharma, it was simply fantastic. What you just said in the last 5 minutes was very powerful, and I think all the 5 points mentioned by you were so simple and so basic, yet so important, that I think each and every institution in the country can learn so much from this. Thank you so much for that very insightful talk, and I am sure I'll be calling you after this event again to understand more on that.
You are welcome.
Coming to Dr. Gokhale, sir, during this talk, Dr. Sharma mentioned the word bureaucratic. And with my little experience, we have, I don't want to use that as a tough word, but how can we make institutions less bureaucratic, especially the funded institutions, and how can we remove bureaucracy, add more flexibility in the best interest of students?
Yeah,
and I am asking this sir, because you have a great experience in managing IITs, NITs, and large universities.
Okay. Your last question was, you know, what do you do with the bureaucrats? The simple answer is keep them out of your campus. You know, it is possible. Once you are able to have that particular confidence into yourself that you are not going to do anything wrong, right? The bureaucracy will come about. And then they will accept whatever you are saying. Having said that, all bureaucrats are not bad.
Absolutely.
Because they have what they experience. And if you bring them on board, you know, there's nothing like it. I mean, it's a win-win situation. I have noticed it when I was the director of ENIT Nagpur. You know, my chairman, board of governors, he was formerly the personal secretary to Shankar Dayal Sharma, IAS officer. And he could give me answers, you know, without going roundabout, you know, straight to the point and clear-cut type of dictum on that. Having said that, now I'm going to be a little bit devil's advocate, okay? I'm taking control, so as to say, you know. Not in the same fashion as in Arnav Goswami's television debate soon. But, you know, something that we mentioned, you know, how do we prepare our teachers to take up this particular challenge? It would be indeed presumptuous on my part that all teachers were able to deliver the goods, you know, because the time that was given to them for preparing was very, very short. Right? You know, you go into the lockdown and immediately, what do you say? You know, start teaching them online. Now, if you would look at the teacher, he has to be basically a script writer, okay, cameraman, okay, then sound engineer, right, editor. And this, all these things, you know, he is doing it from his home. Because many times, you know, the campus is for off limit, you know, till such time, you know, things eased out a little bit. You know. If he is in the office, you know, he has got a lot of facilities, library facilities, are there, lab facilities there, and so on and so forth, you know. So teacher has to be prepared. And it is said that if you want to make this particular model a success, you may need about 1 year of a continuous training for the teacher. All right. Second point that I have, you are bringing a three-dimensional classroom into two-dimensional laptop screen where people are in 2 centimeter by 2 centimeter boxes. Okay, this particular thing, whether you are going to use Zoom, Google or Microsoft platform, has got a limitations because human transactions also need something which is called the body language. And that body language is sadly missing. The students on themselves, you know, they need quite a bit of this particular collaborative type of work, right? What are we talking about? You know, I will just mention few things, and I'm quoting now K. Kasturi Rangan, who has drafted the new education policy. And it is for all of us, you know, to take cognizance of, right? So he mentioned 4 things, you know, we are in the knowledge economy and we should be ready for the industry 4.0. In this industry 4.0, there are 2 aspects. One is a holistic education and another one is a multiple specialized domain knowledge. We are not talking about a single domain knowledge now. And that brings you to your interdisciplinary type of work. Now, if you are going to go into this online mode, that interdisciplinary part is nearly absent. You know, because it simply is not possible, you know, that 2 people, you know, one from computer science, you know, is talking to somebody from electrical or mechanical and trying to do something. So that particular thing is seriously missing, you know. The third thing that he mentioned, ethical and constitutional knowledge is important in our education system. Okay. And the 4th thing that he said, developing cognitive abilities, they are something which is extremely important. So we need to work towards this. When he talked about the holistic, you know, there is a MIT ADT with whom I am associated. They have got a well-structured plan, you know, and it is very good. And quite a bit of it, you know, whatever I heard, you know, from all the panelists just now, you know, Santakumar as well as Sharmaji, you know, as well as Avasthi, is that you are doing in your own way. So public dissemination of what we are doing, why is it not advertised on the national network? Let everybody know, you know, that we are doing our bit. We might not be the warriors of coronavirus, you know, just the same way in which the police forces and the armed forces and the doctors and nurses and health professionals are doing. But we are also doing something good to the society, to the system. This has to be highlighted somewhere, you know. Maybe your approach, you know, in having this particular webinar is one such thing, you know, because now we have told it to all the participants, 100, 200 people who are listening to you. At least through them, you know, we will be able to sort of pass on this particular message. I believe, you know, that the student focus, if you want to have, see, if you go into this online, you are again going back to the teacher-centric mode of academic curricula.
Yes.
When you came from the schools, you know, you were teacher-centric, right? When you came to my campus, you know, there was always this particular discussion saying, you know, that am I going into +3? Because in NIT, you know, and IIT students used to ask this question. They said, you know, in the first year of engineering, what are you teaching? You're teaching physics, chemistry, mathematics, English, and so on and so forth. Where is the engineering? Because that is what we came here for. You know. So this type of disconnect, you know, we need to really take care of. You should be able to address it. You know. So some of the things that we were mentioning, you know, Sharmaji mentioned, you know, that Satyam Nadella and you know, those people, they are doing wonderfully well. IBM Google and Microsoft, all three are headed by Indians, right? The question is, why did they have to go out of India, you know, to score a big in the big league? So can we have an ecosystem in India which would nurture these talents, you know, and we will become a challenge, you know? We'll challenge the world. I think this is something, you know, that all the academicians who are listening to us, who are with us, you know, they have to be probably thinking about it, you know, in more than one sense. You know. Collaborative learning should be integral part of it. And somewhere along the line, that particular thing would be missing if we go purely on the online. So 100% online, even in United States right now, is not looked up to. Why? Because reopening of the schools is connected with what? Public health. Students not coming to the university is going to hurt the institution in terms of their financial outlays.
Absolutely.
So these are sort of closely connected type of entities. And we need to really figure it out, you know, whether it is a unlockdown one, unlockdown two, or whatever. When quickly we will be able to come back to near normalcy. Keep the safe distance, keep the masks on, you know. Today, fortunately, none of us are wearing masks, you know, because we are in within our own environment, you know. But keep these bare minimum type of a thing and let us get back to the class. Let us get back to the class and let us get back to the teacher, you know, and the student and their interaction between them, you know, because ultimately what is missing, Guru, you know, if you would look at it, what does the teacher do? He shares the student's anxieties, right? He is open to him, you know, available to him, pick up a phone and start talking to him. He has an empathy for this student and he has a genuine concern, and that makes him a good teacher or an excellent teacher. And this particular part doesn't come through in merely online type of mode, but that is the order of the day. It is going to happen like that, and we'll have to live through it. We have to learn through it and we have to survive. Thank you very much. I would like to thank all the panelists, you know, because I learned quite a few things from them. And
we have a few questions.
Not to me, you know. I am a non-executive person, you know.
No. So
I'm just kidding, you know. Throw it, you know.
Sir, this is more of an academic event, so really it does not matter. It is 4:45 already, and I don't know how time has flown. We have the last 15 minutes for some questions. And we have got some very serious questions from the academicians. I am just reading out the questions that I have received and I have just selected one. I have this question from Dr. Amarjeet Singh, Principal Lanka Mahavidyalaya, Assam. They say the information is very, the interaction is very informative and scholarly. As we know that we have more than 70% students that are from rural background and they cannot afford Android phone to attend the online classes. So this principal, Dr. Amarjeet Singh, they are from Assam and they say that 70% students do not have Android phone yet. How are they going to attend online classes? I think this is a very, very ground level question, but I'm not sure who amongst you has an answer to this. We have three more questions and we have very limited time. So I think Professor Dr. Awasthi wants to answer this.
Yes, I'll just take up. Rightly said that most of the students in rural areas, they don't have access to the Android phone. So government is also thinking a lot. As you know, as we know, as the technology is advancing, this kind of online teaching learning is going to increase. As has been said by Honorable HRD Minister Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank ji on 27th of June, they are going to allow top 100 NRF universities to offer full-fledged online programs. And then we also have that the permissible component of open and distance education, the online content has increased from 20 to 40%. There are a lot of government initiatives, One Nation, One Digital Platform, One Class, One Channel. These kind of initiatives are coming from the government. And secondly, for non-Android kind of teaching learning, probably the audio recording and that can help to certain extent. I don't say they are going to replace the classroom teaching altogether, but the recorded lectures can be there, and then these lectures can be disseminated to the students, or mobile phone kind of teaching can also supplement. I will take one more minute in which I'll just tell about the what are the opportunities we have due to this pandemic. I thought this will be covered in some question. It was not. So approximately around 8 lakhs of the students, they from India were going to abroad. And due to this pandemic now, there is a greater opportunity available to the Indian universities. They need to raise their level so that those students now can come back to the universities or technical institutions of higher learning to the country. So this is one very, very positive point which has come out. So as has been earlier told by me, as our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji say, that this challenge need to be changed and converted into opportunity. So this is one opportunity. The second opportunity which we have is we can definitely go come up and develop the course materials. The third is that a lot of market share, like companies like maybe Mastersoft can come together with the technical institution like NIT Jalandhar, and we can have a lot of market for virtual laboratories. The practical aspect of teaching learning is totally ignored due to online teaching learning. So can we have simulated softwares to complement, or can we have some immersed situations with virtual reality so that the people can have that kind of opportunity is also there. And there is definitely opportunity for devising new AI-based solutions for examination. Because examination online is another challenge. How to examine and how to find out. So this is another solution which can be provided by the tech-savvy companies and the institution together. And more kind of online software for classes can be developed. And we can look for that everything right from admission to teaching, learning, everything online. So this kind of environment can be there. So the question I've answered, but I've put up, these are the some of the opportunities which can be shared through the fraternity. So all academicians, they can come together, and industry like you can come together to solve this problem. And
thank you. Thank you, sir. Dr. Sharma, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, I wanted to add our experience to it. There is a possibility that they can check with their district administration, which is helping reaching out to the students with gadgets. Even in villages at Gram Panchayat level, they have the facilities and they are assisting the students free of cost. So if they can coordinate with Gram Panchayats and district administration offices, including police, I can assure you it has worked wonders for us. More than 360 plus students, very remote corners, could appear in the examination at the district level facilities, and they allowed them, and they have connectivity as well as the gadgets in their offices. So they would definitely help. So I would advise that if you have certain numbers, you reach out to them. we even took help of our alumni who were there in certain districts, and they also reached out and provided gadgets. So those kinds of some simple solutions can be looked into. If there the numbers are very much addressable, but if there are large numbers, then they can easily work with the education department and figure out the best possibility. Because every district has colleges and institutions, have computer labs, schools have labs. So it's only about coordination, and things can happen.
So basically, what I have understood from the crux is, we have people who are resource rich. We have people who need it. There is a requirement to connect the resource rich people to the people who actually need it. And I truly believe that Gram Panchayats can play a very important role. I'm not sure and I'm not aware the kind of infrastructure that the Gram Panchayats today have. But if we have the right people at the right place, getting the resources is not a problem. Dr. Gokhale also wants to add something.
Yeah. I was involved in setting up NIT in Mizoram.
Yes.
And that is as northeast as you can get.
Yes.
I had to go through Assam. Northeast has got a peculiar problem. You know, I mean, undoubtedly, you know, they are struggling. Things hopefully should work for them. I visited Mizoram campus about 2 years ago, and they are still trying to put up things together. There were something like 8 NITs in the Northeast region, including the one in Jammu Kashmir, you know, Srinagar basically, you know, they were set up, and they were, the government is willing to put in money, but they are not able to put things in proper place. I think I was told that the government of India is trying to open up TV channels. And through the TV channels, you know, they are trying to deliver the course
material.
That is
true.
Currently only that Gnyan Darshan Vagera Ego channels say, but now there are more channels they are going to open up. Hopefully, they would add some value to deliverance.
Okay.
Thank you.
I am taking one last question, and this is the question that is being asked for the first time. And even like this is my third session, and in every session we are getting hundreds of questions. This question is asked by Dr. Madhulata Vyas. She says in Hindi, "Sir, kya lipi ka vikas piche nahi reh jayega online padhai se?" I mean, yes. While I was reading this question, we are having this complete conversation in English. Perhaps when I would have met you in person, my first interaction would have been in English, but slowly it would have gone to Hindi. But in the online medium, we have been using English as a mode of communication, perhaps in a country where India, where Hindi is the highest spoken. So I would like to thank Dr. Madhulata Vyas from R.M. Patel College. I would like to throw this question to all of you. Are we really missing on Hindi and the regional languages, especially in the mode of writing? Because the softwares we have, Microsoft Word, or even all the solutions that we use, Google Sheets, Google Documents, are all from US-based companies. So are we losing Hindi and other vernacular languages? Yeah, over to you, Dr. Sharma. Yes.
A very good question. But to respond to it, I would say that it is just the start of what has happened. And when things start, it gives us the opportunities. It's important that we realize the challenge. The question is not only related to the language, but also about physically challenged students. Because if we have a visually impaired student, probably online education might be a troublesome part for them. So eventually, we will see that a lot of tools would come, a lot of content will develop, And we should take it as a challenge on ourselves. That when we know that this is something which has come, let's overcome it. Like we adopted the online mode to overcome the situation. So there would be gaps. Initially, there will be gaps. There is no doubt about it. But we have to work in a mission mode. Probably the way we look at how China came so fast, so forward into higher education, like a missile, they came forward in 3 decades. And from nowhere, they started jumping into the top rankings. It's a similar kind of story. A challenge comes to you. You know that this is the challenge. And let's start working. Let's do the collaborations. And language has to be taken to its potential. Because if we talk about Generation Z, there is Generation X, there is Y, and now Generation Z, which is in an age bracket of 5 to 25. Now, this is a generation, and post it, the Alpha generation, which is coming back to back, is going to spend majority of the time. They are born with gadgets. So they are going to spend their times. So when you know that this is a challenge, whether Corona had happened or not, in spite of it, we have to figure out developing all the online content, material, and methodologies to reach out to this generation, to educate and handhold them on languages. So what I feel is that it's realization is the starting point, and converting that realization, addressing the challenge, is the best way you can answer it. Because 100 years down the line, you do not know how things would happen. So you have to evolve at every challenge which comes to you. Technology has come as a booster, as well as a challenge to be addressed. Adapting and evolving over it is something we have to figure out.
Perfect.
Guru, I would like to just add one point, you know, in this. Machine learning and artificial intelligence would enable the language translators. Language translation is indeed just around the corner, you know. Now the thing is that, you know, whether you will be, you got to find out the customer size. Currently, we are talking about a technical education, you know, which has got a predominantly English as their operating language or working language. But the machine learning and AI would enable you for this particular language translation, you know. So you speak in something and it will be translated into something else. So that should be no problem.
Even as we speak, I have got a text from one of the audiences. She's from Hyderabad. She says, "Hi, I am Dr. Kameshwari, Bhavans College, Sainik Puri, Secunderabad. There are different types of softwares which have Hindi fonts and we can type in Hindi." And she says that she's doing a complete research on it.
Right.
So this is something amazing that even as we are speaking, we are already at 5 p.m. and respecting the time of my panelist and my audience, I would like to put a break here. We have had eminent educationists joining us from across the country. I would like to thank a few of them for joining. I would like to thank Dr. Ansi Jose, ma'am, from NK College Mumbai. I would like to thank the principal of Sophia College, Mumbai, who have joined us. I would also like to thank Professor Dr. Milind Prakash Naik, Assistant Director of MIT WPU. We have had 150 eminent academicians who have joined us. And unfortunately, I cannot name all of them. So I would like to thank all my panelists, all my audiences with folded hands. Thank you for joining us. This has been a great conversation. I look forward to connect with you offline also, so that we can add so much more value to it. I would like to give my special thanks to Professor Lalit Kumar Awasthi from NIT Jalandhar for extending us an invite for collaboration. Sir, I am going to get on a call with you, and I'm looking forward to collaborate with NIT Jalandhar. This has been a distant dream. Our MD had visited NIT Jalandhar way back in 2001. So you have a beautiful campus. So,
yes.
Again, looking forward. Thank you, Professor Sharma, Professor Shantakumar, Dr. Gokhale, thank you all so much. Truly, each one of you, if I can just point out a few of them, Dr. Shantakumar, the work that you have done in taking migrant laborers, had that been a highlight during that period, every university, every college would have done something. And I feel that we would have a very different scenario from Dr. Sharma's, the taking a 5 kilometer radius, adapting that part of that university to using drones to that immune booster khakra. I would be calling you for the recipe. So much innovation, Dr. Awasthi's air purifier mask, and the experience shared by Dr. Gokhale. I believe there is so much that we have taken away from here. And one, I would like to conclude today that we may have online learning, we may have AI, we may have ML, we may have hundreds of technology solutions, but the Guru Shishya Parampara of India, that has to remain constant.
Yeah.
Whether we are online, whether we are offline, whether we are in class, whether we are in 3D, whether we are in 8D, the Guru Shishya Parampara. And you know, one thing, last time we had a speaker from NIT Goa, we had the director of NIT Goa, and he told us very candidly, you know Gurudev, earlier students used to have a limited teachers, but now Vidwana Sarvatra Pujyate, you can have teachers from across the world, and the teachers would be respected across the world for their learnings, because now technology has enabled that teaching can be taken throughout the world. So as we were taught in class 9th, Swadeshe Pujyate Raja Vidwana Sarvatra Pujyate, I think this is the time for the best teachers to come out and give their learnings to across the globe in any language. I don't really feel language is a barrier. I could have spoken today in Hindi or Marathi or English or in any language. So thank you so much. I actually want this to continue, but we have to,
take
the time also. So thank you so much. I look forward to connect with all of you offline also. Thank you so much.
Thank you. God bless.
Thank you.
Before we leave, I would request all the participants to unmute their videos. And, you know, as we are having everything virtual, we can also have a virtual group photograph.
Yes. Superb. We have all the audiences who have switched on their videos, and thank you for patiently hearing us out. Excellent. Let's say cheese.
Cheese.
Let's pray that Corona goes away and we get back to our normal lives.
Right.
Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us today.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. And very good evening to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Requesting host to please end meeting for all.
Thank you.